الحمد لله، الصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحابته ومن والاه، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وصفوته من خلقه وحبيبه، قد بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة وجاهد في سبيل دينه حتى أتاه اليقين، فاللهم اجزه عنا وعن والدينا وعن الإسلام والمسلمين خير ما جزيت به نبيا عن قومه ورسولا عن أمته. اللهم أحينا على سنته وأمتنا على شرعته، واسقنا من يده الشريفة شربة هنيئة مريئة لا نظمأ بعدها أبدا. اللهم أمين. Brothers and sisters, we are continuing to dig deeper into the vulnerabilities and the weaknesses of our ummah, to understand the crisis in which our ummah has been going through for centuries. Our ummah has been torn apart, occupied by several powers, manipulated, its treasures and wealth has been stolen, its people have been indignified and humiliated, and we are continuing in this saga for centuries. It is about time that we know what the Quran says about this crisis and what the Prophet ﷺ describes as the root cause of these diseases that led to the breakdown of our ummah as we see it today, and the wide holes of vulnerabilities that allowed the enemies of Islam to take advantage of our ummah. This is the purpose of this series of khutab and that subject. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, لا ترجعوا بعدي كفارا يضرب بعضكم رقاب بعض. Don't go back to the days of pre-Islamic jahiliyyah and kufr. Can someone get me a different mic? This one is breaking down. So don't go back to the days of jahiliyyah and kufr, chopping each other's heads. Because the Arabs before Islam, they used to fight for years on end. It may be a stolen camel, it may be a child that was a subject of difference between two tribes, and the wars go into generations. Sometimes 40 years on end. So the Prophet ﷺ is saying, don't go back to those days. Allah has blessed you by making you one ummah. وَإِنَّ هَذِهِ أُمَّتُكُمْ أُمَّةً وَاحِدَةً وَأَنَا رَبُّكُمْ فَاعْبُدُونَ وَأَنَا رَبُّكُمْ فَاتَّقُونَ سُورَتَي الْحَجِّ وَالْمُؤْمِنُونَ points to the fact that not only the ummah of Muhammad is one ummah, but the umam of all the prophets, all the believers who believed in Allah and believed in the prophets, we all constitute one ummah. And this is something that we did not appreciate. We did not appreciate Allah telling us that we must live as one ummah, we must relate to each other as one ummah. We did not appreciate the Prophet ﷺ telling us that the example of the believers in their compassionate love and attachment to each other is like that of one body. If one part of the body aches, the whole body aches and suffers sleepless nights and fever. We don't appreciate all of this. What and when do we start appreciating what Allah is telling us? When does the Quran mean in reality that we turn it into a way of life? The Quran is a theory. It is an offer. It is a guidance. It is on us to turn it into reality and benefit ourselves and our next generations from the guidance of the Quran. It's on us to turn it into reality. Instead of working to that end, we are questioning Allah's promises. Where is the victory? You promised the believers that you stand with them. You told us, إن الله يدافع عن الذين آمنوا. And some of our young and old are actually taking those issues as foundation to leave Islam altogether. Asking the wrong question, directing the question to one who is never to be questioned, instead of asking ourselves, are we up to the believers that Allah describes in the Quran? إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهُ وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُهُ زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا وَعَلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ. This is the description of the believers in the Quran. أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ حَقَّ. These are the true believers. حَقَّ, which means there are a lot of false believers. Believers who make the claim but never mean to live up to the claim. And that's why the Quran clearly says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا آمِنُوا. O you who believe, believe. He's telling us, announcing your faith is only an entry point. But to be a believer, you have to practice what you claim to believe in. If you believe in Allah, follow Him. If you believe in the Prophet, follow Him. If you believe in both, وَأَطِيعُ اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُ الرَّسُولُ. Obey Allah and obey His Messenger. Now we are flagrantly disobeying Allah and then questioning, why didn't you, Allah, deliver us out of the crisis that we put ourselves in? As if we have no role either in creating the crisis nor in getting ourselves out of the crisis. We have to pull ourselves out. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala يَبْسُطُ يَدَهُ بِاللَّيْلِ لِيَتُوبَ مُسِيءُ النَّهَارِ وَيَبْسُطُ يَدَهُ بِالنَّهَارِ لِيَتُوبَ مُسِيءُ اللَّيْلِ حَتَّى تَخْرُجَ الشَّمْسُ مِنْ مَغْرِبِهَا. Allah extends a hand, His hand, at the night for people who have messed up during the day, and in the day for people who messed up at night, until the sun rises from the west. So we are in a ditch, and Allah Himself is stretching His hand to reach down to us, to pick us up. And we are not stretching our hand to Him. We are stretching our hands to our own enemies. We think they, the cause of our disease, is going to be the treatment. Enough is enough. We've tried that way for centuries. It is time that we wake up and extend our hands only to Allah, to beg Him, to humble ourselves before Him, to acknowledge our own mistakes, and to accept responsibility, and to craft a plan to pick ourselves up until our hands reach His. Because it's on us, as He reaches down to us, that we reach up to Him. We are reaching to everybody around, specifically our enemies, to save us from each other. What a shame. What a shame. How do we meet the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and everybody's claiming to be, but I am the one that is right? How do we meet the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? How do we even meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and tell Him, we are the ummah that you meant us to be. We are one ummah. We love one another. We protect one another. We take care of one another. Our ummah is materially rich, but militarily weak. Because it's politically broken down. And it is broken down politically because our spiritual relationship with each other and with Allah and within ourselves is completely shattered. We only come back to Allah when we are way down in the ditch. Now, where lower do we go? There is no more lows to go to. We are in the bottom of the bottom. It is time to go back to Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, وَلَا تَنَازَعُوا فَتَفْشَلُوا وَتَذْهَبَ رِيحُكُمْ. Don't you live in disputes and fights within, with each other. فَتَفْشَلُوا, because you will fail. Telling us clearly what the disease is. We are breaking down our own ranks. We hate what we love and we live by what we hate. We hate nationalities and the borders that the enemies set for us. But we love to live by what we hate. We're proud to be Egyptians, Pakistanis, Mauritanis. Everybody is proud of the flag that was imposed on us. We hate crossing the borders, but we're proud that we have borders. We are perplexed. We are our worst enemies, and we don't even recognize it. We don't want to recognize it. It is time that our ummah become mature, to act like mature, adult, grown-up people. Look at problems with an open eye. Look at difficulties and challenges and resolve to face them head on. Don't run from our problems. We shouldn't. Until now, whenever any ummah of our Muslim nations are in trouble, where do they go? They go to the enemies. Either for money, or for weapons, or for tactics, or for intelligence, where there is none. And they leave completely what Allah has given us of reasons of power. I have heard several Western analysts and reporters and journalists looking at the Muslim Ummah. Do you know what they are saying? They are saying Muslims are very strange type of people. They are very strange type of people. They almost speak one language, about 300-400 million of them, the Arab world, which is the heart of the Muslim world. They have one book that they believe in. They have one center of gravity, which they call Al-Kaaba, that makes them supposedly united in direction. They claim to believe in one God, but their earthly gods are shattering them apart. When we made Russia our God at one point, or the Soviet Union, it took us decades to discover they are not going to save us. From the demise of the Soviet Union, now we think that Washington is the other God. And Washington is going to save us. Wherever they tell us go, we do. Because they are our savior, not Allah. And in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, مَنِ اتَّكَلَ عَلَى شَيْءٍ تَكَلَهُ اللَّهُ إِلَيْهِ. If you rely and depend on something, Allah will leave you and whatever you are relying on. You want America to be your God? Take it, for the God it is not. You want Russia to be your God? And now some Muslim nations are running towards China. China, that has caged 2 million Muslims in torture camps to force them to leave their faith, to stop praying, to stop reading the Quran, to stop building mosques. And they are actively destroying mosques. Even the United Nations has condemned these practices. Guess what? About 7-8 Arab nations who are supposed to be Muslim majority nations led by supposedly Muslim leaders, they say China is good and the United Nations is wrong. If we are not our own worst enemies, then what is? Who is our enemy? We are the worst enemies of ourselves. And they are playing football with us, the people, because we, the people, allowed ourselves to be a football in the foot of those tyrannic regimes. We've accepted them. It's like somebody settling down to live with cancer. Cancer is going to eat you up. It doesn't settle at any border. There are no boundaries for cancer. Once it hits, it goes everywhere. We are letting this cancer eat our resources, eat our leaders, eat even our scholars who are lounging in prisons for no crime, nothing, but speaking up. I know you know it. Could I have spoken like this in any country of our Muslim nations? No. No, I couldn't. You would have been arrested at the door. You, not only me. This is as miserable a reality, even worse than the enslavement of the children of Israel at the hands of Pharaoh and his soldiers. We have turned our ummah, our peoples, into slaves for those regimes. And it is on us to change a coin and to turn corners. It is on us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُوا مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ. We have to change the ways we deal with issues, with people, with the Quran, with the Sunnah, with the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the way we deal with prayer, the way we deal with everything that Allah told us is important. حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُوا مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ. We will never have a different condition for our ummah until we turn a corner, until we start seeing the poor as a blessing, and the weak as a gift, and the underprivileged as a way of mercy for ourselves. But we look at the poor as undesirable. We look at the weak as, you know, useless. We look at the underprivileged as somebody who has put himself down. This is wrong. And that's why the Quran says, كَلَّا بَلْ لَا تُكْرِمُونَ الْيَتِيمِ وَلَا تَحَاضُّونَ عَلَىٰ طَعَامِ الْمِسْكِينِ وَتَأْكُلُونَ التُّرَاثَ أَكْلًا لَمَّا وَتُحِبُّونَ الْمَالَ حُبًّا جَمَّا. You are so much indulged in material, piling up materials and gold and silver and money and bank accounts and houses and cars and all of these toys until we face Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And nothing helps us. When the enemies came to Iraq, what did the wealthy people benefit from their wealth? What benefit? If we believe the stories that came out after, even Saddam Hussein's millions did not help him. Running with a bag of money like a child, it doesn't reflect any dignity, any adulthood. Brothers and sisters, our ummah needs us, the people, the Muslims who live in America. The Muslims who live in America should pay the zakah for their safety, for their freedom, for their liberty, by helping the Muslim world at least understand what problems we all are facing and what is the way out. Allah told us, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, ittaqu allaha haqqa tuqatih. Fear Allah the way He ought to be feared. And protect yourself from His displeasure and anger. وَلَا تَمُوتُنَّ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ. Die not except as Muslims. وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا. And hold tight, all of you together, to the robe of Allah. What is the robe of Allah? In the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, talking about the Quran, he says, هُوَ حَبْلُ اللَّهِ الْمَتِينَ. It is a strong rope dangling to us, brought down to us, sent down to us from Allah to hold on to climb the ladder of dignity and honor. Umar ibn Khattab used to say, نَحْنُ قَوْمٌ أَعَزَّنَ اللَّهُ بِالْإِسْلَامِ. We are a community that Allah has honored us by revealing Islam to us and to the rest of the world through us. فَإِنْ اَعْتَزَزْنَا بِغَيْرِهِ أَذَلَّنَا اللَّهِ. If we seek our dignity and honor in anything else other than Al-Islam, Allah will put us to humiliation. He will dishonor us. He will disown us. He would leave us to our enemies. And that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Himself says in the Quran. He says, إِن تَنْصُرُ اللَّهَ يَنْصُرْكُمْ. If you support the cause of Allah, Allah will support you. وَإِن يَخْذُلْكُمْ. If He lets you down, فَمَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يَنْصُرُكُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ. Who is He who is going to support you besides Allah? Who? Whom are you waiting for still? After the Soviet Union, America, and China, we are waiting for the next empire to come out to hold on to their tails and their legs and beg them to give us some dignity? Yes, the situation of our ummah causes that we tear blood, not tears. It is not a subject of laughter. Our enemies could laugh at us because we have made ourselves the laughing stock of the world. By disunity, we have dishonored our faith. By fighting one another, we have dishonored all what Allah has meant us to be. By borrowing from our enemies to feed our children, we have rendered ourselves as slaves. We have to please them to feed our children, even though Allah has put into our hands blessings and treasures and gifts that nobody else has. Sudan, before its division, it had the largest oil fields in Africa. Somalia is now about to discover the largest gas reserves in the world on the coast of Somalia. Yemen is discovering gas and oil. That's why Yemen is at war. Syria went to war to protect its oil. I'm not talking about the government. I'm talking about those freedom fighters who stood against the government to protect their country and to remove the tyrannic regime, to have control over their own destiny. This is how we should live. We should live a life of jihad, fighting back against those who fight us, those who manipulate us, those who are breaking the ranks of the Muslim community and stealing our resources and selling us cheap slaves and labor to the rest of the world who is not even accepting us as laborers. Europe is in need for labor. Muslims have the largest immigrant community in history these days, but Europe is not opening for us. Europe is not receiving Muslim immigrants. They are fighting them. Brothers and sisters, we should take a back seat and step back and look at our miserable, miserable situation and look at the answer given to that eternal question, why? And you will find the answer in front of you in Surah Taha. وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكَ. He who turns away from my reminders, he would lead a miserable life. Have we seen the miseries yet? Is it clear why? Do we still need to rediscover the Quran and the Sunnah? Or do we need to continue to neglect the Quran, neglect the Sunnah, and invite all the experts of the world to come and analyze the misery we made with our own hands? We made those miseries our way of life. We've turned miseries into our comfort zones. Now our peoples are happily supporting despotic regimes. Why? It has become their comfort zone. It has become a way of life. They live on the crumbs of Pharaoh and his ilk and his elite everywhere. And they see for themselves no way out. And that's why you will find that the root of atheism and leaving Islam in our nation is rooted in the political miseries that we have called upon ourselves. Unless we unite, we will never get relief. Unless we hold on together, all of us, to the robe of Allah, the Quran, and the Sunnah of the Prophet, we will never unite. Nothing will unite us. Arab nationalism failed us. Secular Arabs failed us. Arabism failed us. The only thing left for us is Islam, or to throw ourselves in the hands of our enemies as slaves and laborers to beg for a chance to live. No third option. Wise people, adults and grown-ups, when they are faced with a wall, they have one of two things to do. Either they go through the wall or they take a U-turn and go back where they should be and start the marathon of reform, reforming myself, reforming my family, reforming my community, reforming my ideas, reforming my way of life, reforming the way I use my resources, reforming the way I raise my children, reforming the way I treat my spouse, reconciling the infights inside the community, and standing all together as one body, as the Quran describes us, and as the Sunnah and the Hadith of the Prophet describe us. This is the only way around where we are. The disunity, the fighting, the bloodshedding of Muslims against Muslims has rendered us as slaves in the hands of our enemies. Some of us are part of this enslavement. I don't mean to demean anybody. I respect everyone working halal job. It's fine. Earn your living halal way, you are a king. Alhamdulillah. But mind you, tens of thousands, if not more, of Muslims who are doctors and engineers and scientists who migrated from our countries because of these despotic regimes, they landed in the West as cab drivers, shopkeepers, and the skills and the knowledge they had earned is rendered to waste. Who's losing? Our Ummah is losing. Why are they fleeing? Because the regime is not helping people to help themselves. The regime is itself out for sale for the highest or lowest bidders outside, and they want the entire population to follow them as slaves. We should never succumb to this. And our community in America should be the leading force for education, for awareness, for charting the road for dignity for our Ummah. This is part of our responsibility, to speak up on their behalf, to fight the forces of evil who want to continue to enslave the rest of our Ummah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us to do what is right. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us see the way to our unity and the way to our dignity and the way to our power. Alhamdulillah wa kafa wa salatu wa salamu ala ibadihi alladhina astafa wa ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluhu wa safwatuhu min khalqihi wa habibuhu qad ballagha ar-risalata wa adda al-amana wa nasaha al-ummah wa kashafa al-ghumma Allahumma ajzihi anna wa an walidayna wa an al-islam wal muslimin khayra ma jazayta bi nabiyyan an qawmi wa rasulan an ummatihi. Inshallah, as many of you must have heard, the authorities in Saudi Arabia have announced the beginning of Dhul Hijjah as today, which is Friday, and the Eid will be on Sunday, not this Sunday, Sunday the 11th of August. And those days, the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah, have been marked by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as the days for any good deed. The best days for any deed in the sight of Allah are the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. ما من أيام العمل الصالح فيها أحب إلى الله من العمل الصالح في العشر الأوائل من ذو الحجة. قيل يا رسول الله ولا الجهاد في سبيل الله؟ قال ولا الجهاد في سبيل الله إلا رجل خرج بنفسه وماله ولم يعد من ذلك بشيء. Doing something righteous in these days is better than doing anything righteous in any other day. It's like the 10 nights of Ramadan. The last 10 nights of Ramadan are the greatest nights. These are the greatest days for righteous deeds. And the righteous deeds are not limited to just fasting. Fasting is part in the Sunnah. Fasting the day of Arafah, which is the 9th of Dhul Hijjah. In particular, يُكَفِّرُ سَنَةً قَبْلَهَا وَسَنَةً بَعْدَهَا. It expiates our sins a year before and a year after. Definitely, nobody should be mistaken by saying, so I can sin the next year. That's not what it means. We hope that when you are righteous, you don't violate Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at any time. Also, Dar al-Hijrah has always been pioneering some programs that help our community. We have a lot of people who need our help. So they have the sacrifice program and the udhiyah. This year is going to cost about $199, not 200, it's 199. And this udhiyah is sacrificed here, distributed here, and if you could afford it, they are not going to give you 30% as usual, or as they have been promising several years, but this year it is only that you will give them the money, they will buy the sacrifice, do it in your name, and distribute it to the poor and the needy. They found it difficult to run back with the third and so on and so forth. So we hope that, inshallah, today we get at least 50 sacrifices from our community to go back. Salat al-Eid, inshallah, on Sunday, August the 11th, we will have Salah at 6:30, 7:30, 8:30, 9:30, 10:30. So from 6:30 in the morning, every 1 hour there will be Salah until 10:30, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless those days of ours and help us do the best righteous deeds and accept from all of us. Allahumma ahdina fi man hadayt, wa afina fi man afayt, wa tawallana fi man tawallayt, wa qina wasrif anna sharra ma qadayt. اللهم اقسم لنا من خشيتك ما تحول به بيننا وبين معصيتك، ومن طاعتك ما تبلغنا به جنتك، ومن اليقين ما تهون به علينا مصائب الدنيا. ومتعنا اللهم بأسماعنا وأبصارنا وقوتنا ما أحييتنا، واجعله الوارث منا، واجعل ثأرنا على من ظلمنا، ولا تجعل مصيبتنا في ديننا، ولا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا، ولا إلى النار مصيرنا. اللهم لا تدع لنا في يومنا هذا ذنبا إلا غفرته، ولا دينا إلا قضيته، ولا همّا إلا فرجته، ولا كربا إلا نفسته، ولا مريضا إلا شفيته، ولا مبتلا إلا عافيته، ولا مسافرا إلا سالما رددته، ولا طالبا إلا وفقته، ولا ميتا إلا رحمته، ولا مجاهدا إلا نصرته، ولا طاغية ولا جبارا إلا قصمته، إنك على كل شيء قدير. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم، فستذكرون ما أقول لكم، وأفوض أمري إلى الله، إن الله بصير بالعباد. وأقم الصلاة.